Ngowi TV, informed economies and business perspective.
When it comes to issues related to international taxation and a capital flight, these are normally issues that are hidden. So what the book does in terms of lifting the veil, it's kind of put it in a very plain field, making it clear, making it open, making it accessible, making it understood, really. So really, the book kind of lifts the veil, kind of opens, exposes really issues related to international taxation and the capital flight from Africa for issues that are normally hidden. So the book tries to expose them. Capital flight generally is not a problem as such. What is problem is illicit capital flight. There is illicit capital flight and illicit capital flight. Illicit capital flight is this legal one where people, you know, capital flows from one country to another, you know, follows the required regulations, follows the, you know, regulations of the country, the central banks, etc., you know, those kind of stuff. But then what is the problem, and this is now the focus of the book, is illicit capital flight. Illicit capital flight where capital is flying from one country to another, and in this broad perspective, from Africa to more developed parts of the world. And it's a big problem because we are talking in terms of millions of US dollars, you know, per annual. You know, I might not have exactly figure, but we understand it's a big problem. And what is happening is multinationals normally, but also individuals from Africa mainly, and other parts of the world, of course, kind of taking capital, taking lots of money from, in this context, from Africa to what we call a tax havens. Yeah, to places like the Cayman Islands, places like Switzerland, places like some of the Caribbean islands, etc. So it's a big problem because, again, here we are talking about money that is illegally earned, illegally transferred to this part of the world. It can be money that is coming from grand corruption, it can be money coming from tax evasion, it can be money coming from pirate activities, it can be money coming from human trafficking, it can be money coming from drug traffic. So this is the broad context and illicit capital flight. And it's very clear to understand the key capital flight as a whole is not a problem, but the problem is illicit part of it. Among other things, the book, as you might see, has a number of contributors. Some of them now have worked a lot on this area, so they have tried to give estimation in terms of figure, how much are we talking about. Some have also discussed whether we are really having correct figures. You know, if you read what Maya Forster, for example, wrote, she has written on the questioning, really, issues like these big numbers on these financial flows, are they misleading, are they correct? You know, if you read works like Becker has done, you know, they have tried a lot to estimate that people have written on methodology. So when it comes to those issues, there have been estimation, there have been discussion on issues, but of course, most importantly, what the book has done is looking at the consequences of these flows from the developing world, what happens to Africa. And we could see in the broad introduction of the book, Professor Ord and others, and we, others who have written, really the focus is when there is this huge capital flow from Africa, the consequences are negative to the people of Africa, especially the poor, the marginalized, you know, men and women who suffer because this capital has just left the continent to elsewhere, you know, in terms of missed public goods and services, education, health, water, infrastructure, you name them, you know. So that is the broad context under which this has been spoken about. Again, some other works have tried to link capital that is flying from Africa to the misery of the continent, to death, to the women who are unable to deliver safely, to people who are unable to cross one side of the valley to another to get education, to people who are dying because of ill health, because of lack of water, because of diseases, because of lack of medicine, etc. So really the problem is more than just the number of money, amount of money that we are talking, the problem lies behind these numbers, the lives behind the number, the suffering behind all these numbers. There are various recommendations, really, based on the various chapters that have been presented. And there are recommendations that will be very specific to governments of Africa, that will be specific to multinational companies that are evading tax and involved in capital flight, but also recommendations that really would concern individuals, because capital flight relates not only for companies, multinationals, there are also individuals that are involved. There are recommendations for we in the academia, there are recommendations for the media, there are recommendations for civil society organizations. But broadly speaking, the broad recommendation is really everyone should fight to make sure that this problem is finished, actually. Of course, we understand it will be a process, it's not an event, it may take time, but then if everybody puts his or her effort on this, really it will work. The government's work on what the governments have to do to end this, it could work. For example, we have recommended, like the UN, United Nations has to also contribute a lot in fighting these issues. The governments have to also contribute. People in the media have to spread the word, have to do lobbying and advocacy, for example, in terms of a civil society organization. And we understand quite a number, like a tax justice network. We have tax justice Network Africa, we have Tax Justice Network in Norway, for example, we have people like Action Aid, you know, people like Oxfam, and people like Police Forum in Tanzania, and others really, who have worked a lot in making these things really known and lobbying and advocating against them. Parliamentarians, for example, members of parliament have a very great role to play when it comes to, you know, reducing these issues. But also individual government, like when you're talking about tax haven, for example, it's what we call now secrecy jurisdiction. There are countries, there are governments that are facilitating all this to happen. There is no way one can take his or her money to Switzerland, to Cayman Islands, to the Caribbean islands, to Delaware, for example, the seat of land, and now to Mauritius, without real facilitation from a government. So recommendations again will be governments really should collaborate to break this secrecy around a tax haven thing. But of course, those of us in the academia, those of us in the media really have to educate masses and simplify these essentially technical issues into simple things that people can really understand. And I think the book tries a lot to do this. And this has been done in the broad context of the Taxation Institution and Participation TIP project, where Christian Mikkelsen Institute of Norway and Professor Ott and Mzumbe University and myself, Prof. Ngowi, we have been working a lot, and we have tried to digest the complex issues into very simple languages. Personally, have been digesting this into Kiswahili on Mwananchi articles, several of them really, writing in very simple languages. I understand Ott has been writing in Norwegian, we have been writing in English, so really I think everybody has a role to play in making these essentially complex issues very simple for broader public consumption. The prominent guest in the launching, Her Excellency Norwegian Ambassador to Tanzania, she spoke about those things. But you know, at the end of the day, really, it should not be just a book for its own sake. It should be a book that gives results. Actions should be taken based on what has been said here. You know, if no actions are taken, it means capitals keep on flying from Africa. Tax evasion will continue, tax havens will continue to operate, and that will be very, very unfortunate. So the greatest negative impact that I see is, of course, growth. For example, Africa may be stating economic growth, but this growth may not really trickle down to the normal man and woman on the street, because again, money is taken and hidden elsewhere. You know, if there is again, actions are not taken and tax evasion continues, it means governments of Africa, Tanzania being one of those, will not be able to get, you know, the public financing on public finance from their own sources, which is highly needed to provide public goods and services. What does this mean? It means either you don't provide adequate public goods and services in terms of health, education, water, security, infrastructure, you name it, or if you do it, then you have to borrow. If you borrow, then the national debt will keep on swelling. It's always a debate in Tanzania. National debt is very big and keep on increasing. Alternative, of course, will be borrowing, where you increase the national debt, or depending on aid. When you depend on aid again, there are a lot of negative results. You know, there may be a lot of conditionalities, but again, we know aid money sometimes doesn't come on time, doesn't come on the amount that was promised, etc. So, to put it clear, if recommendations given here do not really are not implemented, it will be very, very unfortunate to the African continent, but especially for the poor men and women who suffer because of lack of funds that are finding their way to tax havens. We had the launching of the book at Mzumbe University, Dar es Salaam Campus College, and on the 30th of November, and it went very well, really. Now, that is not really the end of the story. You know, after launching now, it's dissemination, it's distribution of the book, it's making the book well. More known to all those who have to know it, you know. You would see, for example, on the launching day, number of copies were distributed to all those who came. We are talking about almost, almost over 100 copies distributed exactly on the launching day. We are also given the website where you can get the soft copy of the book, you know, www.cmi.no, for example, to start with. And of course, it will be made available elsewhere. But also, as from Mzumbe University and myself, we are going to distribute it to several libraries, like your Tanganyika Library, the National Government Library, library of the various universities here, Mzumbe itself, University of Dar es Salaam, IFM, you know, Institute of Tax Administration. We are going to take copies to the Minister of Finance. We are going to take copies to Tanzania Revenue Authority, you know, and others really who have a stake to do in this. Today, I've received the calls from members of parliament wanting copies for themselves and to their constituencies. For example, I received a call from Honorable Deodorus Kamala, the member of parliament from Kenge, way back in Kagera. He wants to take it to read for himself, but also to take it to his constituency. For example, we'll also be taking copies to the parliament, you know, because they have a library there. It's good if parliamentarians can read these things. It will make it very easy for everybody really to understand. And of course, we'll be producing newspaper articles, etc., etc., so that really it moves out of shelves, it moves out of our computers to the broader world. Of course, after the Tanzanian launch, we expect there may be a launch again in Zambia, where Caleb Fundaga is part of the team and is the former governor of the Bank of Zambia, very influential person. He's in Zambia, but he's very influential in the neighboring Zimbabwe. We also expect to have a launch in somewhere in Norway and Oslo towards early 2018. So really, plans are to make the book really filter and reach as many people as possible who would otherwise not have received it. And remember, and thanks to the Research Council of Norway, the book has been distributed, we say, free, but actually it is Norwegian taxpayers who have kind of paid for it in advance. Mm-hmm. So it's not so easy to get such a high-quality book for free. The book is very, very important in terms of content that are inside here. Mm-hmm. You know, it's very important because the contents in here are written in a very well thought manner. You know, the authors that have contributed in here are, you know, gurus on their own in this field. We have people who have researched on these areas for almost all their lives, you know. Or, for example, I researched on this over 30 years. I've been in these areas over 20 years, and I know so many others who have contributed a lot in here. We have also people who are practitioners. Caleb Fundaga, for example, from Zambia, has been the governor of the Central Bank of Zambia. So he knows these things really from fingertips, you know. So I would say it should be really a very important resource book, actually reference book. I understand colleagues from Institute of Tax Administration, we have given them almost they have taken almost 30 books to be put in the libraries. Mzumbe University will be doing the same. I'll be giving some to the National Board of Accountants and Auditors, so that really every student makes use of this, and this is a new knowledge really, and we have a lot of case studies. We have case studies that are as new as November 2017, you know, when we are talking about the Paradise Papers. You know, we had the Panama Papers, now we have Paradise Papers. So it's a very current book, and students who, and of course educators, teachers, professors, who wanted to get most up-to-date issues and feelings and perspectives on tax issues, international taxation, and the capital flight, this is the book to read.